Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we will discuss the various aspects of Green Belt development. Starting with the introduction, Green Belt is a policy that is used in land use planning so as to retain the areas of undeveloped, wild or agricultural land surrounding or neighboring the urban areas. Or we can say that a green belt is an invisible line that designates a border around a certain area, preventing the development of the area and allowing wildlife to return and to be established. The objectives of green belt policy are the protection of natural or semi-natural environments, improvement of air quality in urban parts. It confirms that urban inhabitants have admittance to landscape with consequent informative and recreational opportunities, protection of rural societies that might otherwise be absorbed by expanding cities. Now, what are the advantages of green belt? First is the control of air pollution. Trees remove carbon dioxide from the environment via the process of photosynthesis and the release of oxygen. This way, they help to remove pollutants from air and improve the air quality. A green belt development would trap particulate matter and will help in their removal from the air. Next advantage is noise control. A green belt works as a barrier to the high intensity sound waves. Now the sound waves, they can be deflected, refracted or absorbed by the trees that ultimately reduce their intensity. Now the extent of intensity reduction, it totally depends on the distance of green belt from the source of sound waves. Trees can make impact on humidity and climate, which further affects the sound intensity. The root system of trees binds to the soil particles and help in soil erosion control by improving the soil quality. Green belt retains water and thus prevents the water runoff. Green belt offers area for walking, camping, and biking close to the cities and the towns. Green belt provides habitat for plants, animals, and wildlife. It provides better land use of patterns around the cities. Now, the efficiency of green belt varies depending on the location and the country. They can often be degraded by the misuse by the urban dwellers. Sometimes, infrastructural development compromises with the green belt area. This results in the reduction of green belts and creation of the satellite towns. Next is the history of green belt development. The concept of green belt was initially suggested in the late 19th centuries. In 1898, Evenzer Howard proposed an idea of garden cities. These garden cities, they were intended to be planned and self-contained communities that were surrounded by green belts. These green belts, they contain carefully balanced areas of residences, industries, and agriculture. In the 1930s, Campaign to Protect Rural England, that is CPRE, campaigned for a clear barrier of undeveloped land against urban development and urban sprawl. As a result of these campaigns and other local initiatives, the first green belts were designated in London and Sheffield. By 1955, green belts were firmly supported by both national planning legislation as well as policy. CPRE has continued to be involved in campaigning for green belt designation and permanent protection. Coming to the species that are particularly used in green belt development. Now, first is those plants which counteract the odor. These are bushes with mild but active fragrance, Acacia farnesiana, that is Mexican plant. It is a type of bush with yellow colored fragrant flowers. It doesn't have rich canopy, but it is very effective for counteracting the smell. Its only limitation is its seasonality and thorny nature. Next species is Melaleuca. It has sweet fragrance and thin canopy in India. Next is pine, cedar and junipers. They have excellent canopy and protection. Its only limitation is site specificity. Next is eucalyptus. It can be used as a very good welt and can also be used as per odor source. Its limitation is site specificity and height in the urban neighborhood. Hedges, herbs like tulsi, turmeric, they can also be used for counteracting the odor. Next is vetiver grass. This plant is a king of perfumes and it inactivates the other odors. It affects the nervous systems and relieves the fatigue. It is used as key species in aromatherapy. Next type of plant species are those species which tolerate pollution, like nerium. Nerium is also known as kaner. This plant may or may not have a thick canopy, but it has excellent results with vehicular pollution experimented at National Botanical Research Institute, Lucknow. Other than these species, other species that are used for green belt development are Acacia auriculiformis, bamboo, Pongamia pinnata, neem, casuarina, etc. Coming to the criticism that has been developed due to the green belts. First is housing crisis. The benefits of the green belt might be well intentioned in terms of public health and environment, but these benefits, they do not accrue as intentioned or claimed. Only a small fraction of the population ever sets foot on the green belt for leisure purpose. They claim that a green belt is not strongly causally linked to clean air and water. Rather than the decision of the green belt development is to prevent housing demand within the zone. Next criticism is increasing urban sprawl. A green belt development increases the urban sprawl. Increasing urban sprawl refers to the migration of population from populated towns and cities to low density residential development areas. Examples include Ottawa suburbs of Kanata and Orleans. Both of these are outside the city's green belt and are currently undergoing explosive growth. This leads to other problems, such as residents of those areas, they have a longer travel to workplaces in the city and worse access to the public transport. It means people travel through the green belt. However, this area is not designed to cope with high levels of transportation. Now, coming to the green belt debate. The debate over green belt policy, it falls in two categories. First is its effectiveness as a planning mechanism. Does green belt support the sustainability by encouraging urban regeneration and concentration of homes, services and employment opportunities, or does it prevent sufficient homes being built? Are other tools such as strategic gaps and green badges more effective at creating a sustainable urban form? Should there be more flexibility in terms of permitted development? Second category is its role in environmental management. Does the green belt designation impact on the management of land in the urban fringe? Have the land use objectives for green belt land encouraged positive land management? And what are the best ways of preventing degradation of land in the urban fringe and maximizing productivity of the land and the benefits to the people? coming to the guidelines, regulations, and future challenges for green belt development. Most of the human activities, they generate pollution of different types and magnitudes, to which all the organisms are exposed. Organisms, they tend to avoid or move away from the pollution. By avoidance or by tolerance, organisms struggle and survive in polluted environments. However, such survival is hardly desirable and has certain limitations. Hence, it is imperative that pollution should be controlled at the source itself. Numerous mechanical devices are available for controlling the pollution. However, some trace amount is still likely to get released. Now, in such type of scenarios, green belts are thought to be effective. Green plants, they form a surface that is capable of absorbing the air pollutants. An important aspect of a green belt is that the plants constituting the green belts are living organisms. These plants have certain tolerance limits towards air pollutants. As a result, crossing the threshold limits in terms of pollution load would lead to the injury of plants, causing death of tissues and reducing their absorption potential. This will defeat the purpose of a green belt. In short, we can say that a green belt is effective as a pollution sink only within the tolerance limits of the constituent plants. Now, two types of approaches, they have been recognized while designing the green belts. First approach is source-oriented approach, and second one is receptor-oriented approach. Both these approaches, they have their own advantages as well as limitations. It is generally felt that the first approach is advantageous where a single industry is situated and the pollutants emitted by the same are sought to be contained. The latter approach, that is receptor-oriented approach, is desirable in urban industrial complexes with multiple sources of pollution in an industrial urban mix. Apart from functioning as pollutant sinks, green belts, they provide other benefits like aesthetic improvement and providing possible habitats for birds and animals. Guidelines for green belt development include: first is plant pollutant interactions, second is theoretical models for green belt development, third is selection of plants for green belt, and fourth one is stabilization of fly ash with plants. Now we will discuss in detail all these guidelines. Coming to the first guideline, that is the plant pollutant interactions. Plants are living organisms and hence are prone to suffer toxicity of air pollutants like any other organism. Still, they are expected to scavenge pollutants from the ambient air. Major primary pollutants of industrial origin are considered here. First is sulfur dioxide. It enters plants mainly through the stomata. Hence, stomata, their structure, position and functions are important in the gas entry in a leaf. Once inside the leaf, the gas passes into the intercellular spaces of mesophyll cells and gets absorbed on the bed cell walls to finally diffuse into the cell sap. Initial visual symptoms of foliar injury caused by sulfur dioxide is the formation of marginal and intervenal chlorotic, bronched or necrotic areas starting with dark green or dull coloration with water-soaked appearance. Necrotic areas, they extend and are visible on both epidermal surfaces. Older leaves are the most susceptible ones since they have just attained full expansion. Next is knocks. Three types of oxides of nitrogen are collectively referred as NOx. They are nitrous oxide, nitric oxide, and nitrogen dioxide. Injury symptoms are visible as discolored spots of gray-green or light brown color, bleached or necrotic spots in intervenal areas of leaves. NOx are not considered to be of major concern as phytotoxicants. Next is hydrofluoride. Fluoride enters leaf through stomata and diffuses into vascular tissues from the intercellular spaces of mesophyll. Chlorosis of leaf tip is the first visible injury. Injured brown or dead areas of leaves, they become necrotic, leading to premature leaf fall. Next gases are carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. These are not phytotoxic gases. Next is ammonia. Ammonia injury symptoms include blackening and bleaching of leaves, spotting, brown lesions between veins, and color change of the fruits. Next is hydrogen sulfide. Necrosis and death of young tissues is reported rather than that of old tissues in case of hydrogen sulfide. The plants uptake air pollutants in the following order, which is first is hydrofluoride, then sulfur dioxide, then chlorine, then nitrogen dioxide, then ozone, then PAN, followed by NO, and followed by carbon monoxide. Now, what are the different theoretical models for green belt development? Interaction of pollution with vegetation has always been expressed by a common parameter, and that parameter is known as the deposition velocity of the pollutants. Green belt development model incorporates following parameters for computation of pollution attenuation factor. First is physical characteristics of the green belt. For example, distance from the source, width, height, and leaf surface area density. Second is aerodynamic properties like wind speed through green belt and effective height of the incident air stream. Next is deposition velocity of the pollutant, and final is atmospheric stability conditions. Coming to the application part of green belt model. The green belt model is applied to different cases for studying the usefulness of green belt in reducing the impact of pollution. Out of the two applications, one is a source-oriented approach and other is receptor-oriented approach, and I have already discussed it. In the source-oriented approach, green belt of suitable dimension is planted around a source emitting pollution, and studies are made to know the usefulness of green belt in reducing the effects of pollution for ground level releases. In the receptor-oriented approach, green belt of suitable dimension is planted around an object which is getting deteriorated or is likely to get deteriorated as a result of pollution. Coming to the source-oriented approach, a nuclear power reactor surrounded by a suitably designed green belt is the best example of the source-oriented approach. Now, what are the benefits of developing a suitably designed green belt around nuclear power plant? Firstly, the early and continued mortalities are practically eliminated beyond a distance of 3 km. Secondly, the relocation of population to protect it from long-term external exposure from ground contamination, it may not be required. Next, the supply of food from uncontaminated areas that may be needed for populations living within 2 to 20 km only in the affected sector. Coming to the next approach, that is receptor-oriented approach. Mathematically, both source and receptor-oriented approach are the same. The only difference between the two is the manner in which the green belt is planted. In the source-oriented approach, the green belt is planted around the pollution source, whereas in the receptor-oriented approach, the receptor is protected against pollution by planting a green belt around it. The case of protecting the Taj Mahal against air pollution by a green belt is an example of receptor-oriented approach. Coming to the selection of plants for green belt development. Now, first type of plants for absorption of gases. Tolerance towards pollutants that is not too high to be instantaneously lethal. Secondly, longer duration of foliage. Third, freely exposed foliage through adequate height of ground, openness of foliage in canopy, big leaves having long and broad laminar surfaces, large number of stomatal apertures. Stomata should be well exposed in level with the general epidermal surface. For the removal of suspended particulate matter, height and spread of the crown, leaves should have support on firm petioles, abundance of surfaces on bark and foliage through roughness of bark, epidermal outgrowth on petioles, abundance of axillary hair, hair or scales on laminar surfaces, stomata protected by wax, arches or rings, hairs, etc. It is not necessary that all the tolerant plants, they are good for green belt development. For example, xerophytes with sunken stomata, they can withstand pollution by avoidance, but they are poor absorbers of pollutants due to low gaseous exchange capacity. Next is the plantation along roadsides. Components of green belts on roadsides, they should be both absorbers as well as of dust particles, including even lead particulates. Choice of plants for roadside plantation may be for containment of pollution and for formation of a screen between traffic and roadside residences. This choice of plant should include shrubs of height 1 to 1.5 meter and tree of 3 to 5 meter height. The intermixing of trees and shrubs should be such that the foliage area density in the vertical is almost uniform. Next is the stabilization of fly ash with plants. Fly ash is deficient in plant nutrients like nitrogen and sometimes phosphorus and other minerals and contain toxic metals like copper, cadmium, cobalt, chromium, manganese, molybdenum, nickel, lead, zinc and boron. Amendment of ash with nutrients and agents to arrest toxicants is essential for covering it with plants. Cultivation of grasses stabilizes the ash surface effectively. Grasses with high turnover rate of shoots contribute substantially to the organic enrichment of the otherwise nutrient-poor silty ash. Weathered ash is reported to be substantially less toxic in comparison to the freshly deposited ash. The plants listed are grasses, legumes, multipurpose trees that form a comprehensive agroforestry system. Testing of edible parts of plant for toxic heavy metal contents would help decision making for deriving agricultural yield from stabilized ash dumps. The trees include Bothriochloa intermedia, Brachiaria mutica, Chloris gaena, Cynodon dactylion, Echinochloa colonna, Heteropogon contortus, Sehima nervosum. Now there are some precautions that should be taken while developing the green belt. There are several variables in the environment leading to pollution stress. Major variation is in the set of biogeographical conditions, especially in terms of climate and topography. As a result of which, corresponding modifications in planting strategies become necessary. A large variety of local plant species need to be tried. In case of failure of any of the species to respond as expected, a thorough investigation should be made into the causes of the failures. Such investigations, they provide guidelines for corrective measures and modification in plants. continuous monitoring of plant growth, immediate replacement of casualties, supplementation of nutrients, rescheduling of watering regimes, they are very, very important. Now, what are the future challenges for green belt land? The land around our towns and cities is continuously facing a range of challenges and conflicts land use priorities. Green belt policy has provided a framework for making some decisions around the towns and the cities. It is a simple framework that assumes that urban areas need open space and breathing spaces around them. If not, then urban development would sprawl and settlements would become too big and lose their historic character. The Green Belt policy has defended against this very successfully, but there are new challenges in the 21st century and the new expectations are also there. It is recognized that people benefit from having access to green spaces within a short distance from where they live. Quality places they can visit without driving or a long journey by public transport to get there will be in greater demand. Outdoor spaces that not only provide opportunities for exercise, relaxation or social activity, but which also provides a broad range of environmental benefits and ecosystem services. Now, to tackle these challenges and expectations on finite area of land, a multifunctional approach combining different land uses in the same space is required to plan and to manage the green belt. Students, at last I would like to conclude the module that in this chapter, the writers they have produced general information on the green belt development, its effect on environment and advantages. Some particular plant species used in green belt mentioned were also mentioned along with their features. Commonly employed methods for green belt development were also summarized and the historical aspects of green belt were discussed in brief. In short, one can say that green belt development has received appreciation as well as criticism. Thank you.